Okay, welcome to the Lovecraft eZine videocast and podcast. Today is October the 9th, 2016, and I'm Mike Davis, Lovecraft eZine. And thank you, Matt, before I forget, what you've got a prize to give away.
Yeah, a really good one this week. It is a paperback copy of Cthulhu Fatagan. It is edited by the estimable Ross Lockhart, currently at the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival. It is one of those great books that are coming out from Word Horde. It's just a very, very enjoyable collection of all original mythos fiction.
It's a good book, definitely.
It is good. Enjoyed it.
All right, as usual, yeah, and I've got actually four more prizes. I'll get to that in a second. As usual, now what I'm doing is every Monday I'm using random.org to pick the winners for 8 days before. So basically when I draw the winners tomorrow, it'll be for last week's podcast. So anyone that's watching live has a chance to win. Also, anyone that watches or listens the following week through Sunday. In other words, you have a whole week to listen and get in on the prizes. And we'll tell you how to do that in a bit. Laird Barron gave me some audible.com codes, audiobook codes for X's for Eyes. So I want to give away four more of those on today's show too. So that's a great novella that, I don't know what, 6 months ago or so, Philip, something like that?
Yeah, last summer.
Yeah, something like that. So, okay, so there's prizes, short intros, Mike Davis, I'm with Lovecraft eZine. Let's go with Matt and go down the line here.
Hi there, I'm Matt Carpenter. I help edit the fiction for Lovecraft eZine.
And Philip.
Philip Fricassi. I am a screenwriter and an author.
And Rick.
Rick Lay. I'm a writer and a collector of pulp magazines.
All right, thanks, guys. We might, emphasis on might, if we can get it to work, be talking with Kelly Young at the film festival after we're done talking with Richard. And then SP and Salome, SP's finishing her novel. Salome's unboxed her new computer, but it's not up and running yet. So, and I think Pete might be along a little bit later. So anyway, our guest is Richard Cox, author of The Boys of Summer and Thomas World and a couple of other books. Yeah, let me put Philip on screen. There it is.
Trying to get the glare off it. There you go.
There it is.
So thanks for being on the show, Richard.
Thank you very much for having me, Mike.
So I came across your book in Barnes & Noble, I don't know, a month or two ago. Not very long ago. This one, I mean, The Boys of Summer. That's your newest one.
Right.
And, you know, looked at the back, as you do when you're in the bookstore, and it just seemed extremely interesting to me. We're gonna do our best to do this spoiler free,
right?
For those listening and or watching, can you start with maybe tell us a little bit about yourself, and then we'll talk about your books a bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I'm Richard Cox, and I've been publishing novels since 2004. So I've written four books or published four books during that time. My first novel was Rift, which was a chase thriller that had kind of a science fiction bent to it. And after I wrote that, my publisher, I was with Valentine at the time, and my editor asked me for another science thriller. And, you know, I hadn't really considered myself a writer of science thrillers. You know, I just had picked this particular topic in that book because it interested me. So I moved on to and wrote another novel called The God Particle, which is takes place at a fictional particle accelerator that's very similar to CERN in Geneva and similar to a particle accelerator that was meant to be built in Waxahachie in Texas, but never was built. And
that was going to be in Waxahachie?
It was, yeah.
Man, that's really close to me. I didn't know that.
Yeah, in fact, if you drive down there, you can visit like where the buildings and stuff were going to be built. And I think they dug about 2 miles of the tunnel. And now that's been changed hands several times, and some company, I think, uses it for storage, believe it or not.
Wow.
Yeah, it's like 200 feet below the surface, I think. So, yeah.
Yeah,
so
that's like 45 minutes at most from where I'm at right now.
Yeah. So you would Dallas, I suppose.
I'm about 45 minutes southeast of Dallas, yeah.
Okay.
So
the God Particle was this kind of a thriller where a man who suffers a head injury wakes up, and he is in this Zurich hospital, and these strange doctors brought him back to health, and he begins to think he can see the world in a different way or see the fabric of reality. He's not sure if he's, you know, losing his mind or if something really, you know, amazing has happened to him. And he meets up with this particle physicist who works at this particle accelerator, and they together discover what happened to him and, you know, what he's really seeing. And then after that, I moved over to Nightshade and I published Thomas World there, which is a first person present tense story of a man who's either descending into schizophrenia or again seeing the world in some strange way. And then the final one, the fourth one, is the one we're talking about here, The Boys of Summer, which again is a little bit different in the way it's constructed. It's got several point of view characters and takes place over multiple timelines, but again sort of touches on the idea of bending reality or asking the question, what is reality?
Also first person present tense.
Thomas World is first person present tense, and then The Boys of Summer is just...
Oh, right. I was thinking of Thomas World. I apologize. Yeah. And that was interesting to me because I read The Boys of Summer, and then I picked up Thomas World, and I thought, okay, this is interesting. And at times, again, I don't want to give anything away, but at times, you know, the protagonist is talking directly to the reader.
The reader, yeah. Yeah, I had fun with that because in Thomas World, what I was trying to do was just completely break, you know, we call it the fourth wall, but completely take the wall down between the reader and the protagonist, where they were essentially sharing the same experience or the same world. So it was fun to do that and try and find creative ways to bring the reader, you know, into the consumption and the story itself.
And not only break the fourth wall, but smash it by blaming the reader for what's partly blaming the reader for what's going on.
Sure, yeah.
I love that. So, you know, obviously you don't write Lovecraftian books. You write, in my view, you can disagree, they're your books. In my view, they're one way you could, I think they're hard to classify, but one way you could classify them would be weird fiction, because to me, weird fiction is, you know, things are not as they seem.
Right.
So, which the two books of yours that I've read so far, it certainly is the case. You know, in The Call of Cthulhu, Lovecraft wrote, it starts off with, the most merciful thing in the world, I think, is the inability of the human mind to correlate all its contents. We live in a placid island of ignorance in the midst of black seas of infinity. It was not meant that we should voyage far. And goes on to say that when we learn, someday we'll learn everything we want to learn, we think we want to learn, and then we'll go mad from the revelation or flee from the deadly light into the peace and safety of a new dark age, which, you know, kind of, you know, it makes me think of your work and Philip K. Dick and the nature of reality, because if the world, it's this terrible secret that you think you want to know or about the nature of reality or the nature of the world, yourself from learning, and the protagonist in Lovecraft's stories can't stop himself from learning these things. And when he does, he's not very happy that he learned them.
Right.
So while I don't want to paint a picture here that you write Lovecraftian fiction, there's a correlation there that I found very interesting, you know. So
yeah, and you know, the audience for Lovecraft could be portrayed in a certain way and a little bit less mainstream-esque, I think. And what I'm trying to do with my fiction is similar in theme, but to try to appeal to an audience that might not typically pick up a book of this nature and bring those ideas to them. So it's something in all four of my novels that I've tried to do, whether in The God Particle, you know, touched on hard science fiction, essentially, when talking about theoretical and experimental physics. But then even in The Boys of Summer, I mean, it's far removed from what a typical science fiction novel might feel like, but yet touches on ideas and ultimately is completely about ideas that are very common in science fiction, but are less common, I think, in mainstream fiction.
Yes, because you know the reason why I grabbed it on the shelf was not because was not ultimately the reason why that I greatly enjoyed it. The reason why I pulled it off of the shelf was because it kind of looked like Boy's Life or Summer of Night type fiction or It.
Right. You know,
something along those lines. And that's why that was the hook that drew me in. Sorry, Philip, were you going to say something?
I was just going to say coming of age horror.
Right.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. So you hooked me in with that. So I'm glad I read it.
When we were discussing, Nightshade and I were discussing the cover, I had this idea of this much more moody looking cover with touching on fire and touching on the tornado aspect of the book, and didn't really see this more artistic version that we ended up with. And I just love the cover. And I hope that it does draw readers of all different types to the story. You know, the combination of the cover art and the description on the back. You know, again, it's, as you pointed out, it's difficult to classify my fiction, which I take as an honor. But booksellers don't look at it the same way. You know, they want to point readers in the right direction. And I never know whether I'm going to find my book in the science fiction section, in the horror section, if the store has that, in mainstream fiction, which again, I like, but it makes it challenging to market.
It reminds me a little bit, and not, I always hate to compare authors to other authors, but just categorically speaking, Blake Crouch, you know, who did The Wayward Pines and his new book, Dark Matter. It doesn't hurt that I read the books closely together, but it made me feel like they're both sort of unclassifiable. I mean, I think it's science fiction, but it's also thriller, and it's also got horror aspects. It is certainly hard to classify. It's entertainment, I guess.
Right.
Would be one easy way to do it.
So, Richard, when did you first become, and how did you first become interested in, you know, these types of themes, you know, the nature of reality and so forth?
Well, I don't think I realized my interest in it right away as an author. I mean, I was groomed on a lot of Stephen King. And so, you know, my early attempts at fiction were essentially, you know, trying to copy, you know, what he had done. But I, you know, when I decided to write my own fiction, when I got serious about trying to write novels, I really wanted to get away from supernatural stories, even though obviously this feels like that, but stories that could be grounded in reality, or at least theoretically be grounded in reality. But I still was drawn to the idea, you know, even as a child, I would have lucid dreams at night where I recognized that I was in the dream. And it was just a very compelling idea to me that I could step outside of the reality that I was in. I mean, I'd be 8 or 9 years old, not really understanding the implications of what I was thinking, but still recognizing that how, you know, unusual that would be to basically step outside of the reality that you're in and observe it from a different place, or be aware that you're in this artificial reality. So it naturally crept into my books without really my knowledge of it. When I started writing Rift, as a matter of fact, I didn't even know who Philip K. Dick was, if you can believe that. Even though I had watched films that had been made from his books, I wasn't aware of him. Once I did learn who he was, I obviously went and read a lot of his work and was inspired by that. And that's probably one of the primary reasons, is acknowledging him and the impact that he had on literature and on science fiction in particular. And Thomas World is basically an homage to Philip K. Dick, the way I... you know, if you've read the book, a lot of the characters, almost every character in the book is named after a character in a Philip K. Dick novel. I mean, there's so many little subtle references and Easter eggs that refer to his work. So that's, you know, was obviously very influential.
So, you know, when I briefly reviewed The Boys of Summer on Amazon before I read Thomas World, I threw the name Nick Bostrom out there into the review.
Right.
You know, this is ironically before I read Thomas World.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. So could you, and hopefully I'm not putting you on the spot here, but Nick Bostrom's simulation argument. Could you talk about that, maybe condense that for the people who are listening that aren't familiar with it?
Yeah, I mean, essentially what he's saying, I haven't read the three steps in a while, but the essential argument is, you know, there is a possibility that if, as distilled as you could make it, is if there really is the possibility of having simulated worlds, if we concede that at some point the technology will exist and that the people who created the technology obviously want to put the technology into use, that it seems really likely that they wouldn't just do it the one time. They would probably do it, you know, hundreds, or it depends on what the marketing is, right? For instance, if the real world is 1,000 years in the future or 100 years in the future, depending on how fast you think the technology will evolve, then it might be a World of Warcraft type situation where you've got millions of concurrent users in multiple realities. And so, you know, his argument is, since we know this is probably going to happen, we know that once it does, it's not going to be limited in any real way, then the likelihood of there being simulated realities, there should be many, many more simulated realities than the one reality that we currently occupy. And if that's the case, can't really, it would be a lot of arrogance to assume that you happen to be living in the one reality versus one of these possibly millions of simulated realities. And once I read and understood that argument, I started to really change my internal philosophy. I mean, I moved away. I was raised Catholic, and, you know, even as an early teenager, I was already, you know, moving away from the belief system that I inherited from my mom. But so that left me with a place where I didn't really have a belief system, and I still don't have one, but I guess you could say I feel more agnostic now that I probably am not living in the real world, and that there's some guy somewhere who's consuming our lives in some simulated world, which is in effect like a creator, just happens to be probably a flawed one.
Yeah. Gnosticism and all that.
Right.
There's a physicist named Silas Bean who I think really summed this up really well, the simulation argument, and I'll just read it. He says, in the future, humans will be able to simulate entire universes quite easily. And given the vastness of time ahead, the number of these simulations is likely to be huge. So if you ask yourself the question, do we live in the one true reality, or in one of the many simulations, the answer, statistically speaking, is that we're more likely to be living in a simulation.
Right.
You know, the odds are just against us being in the real world.
They're overwhelmingly against us being in the real world, but still, I think all of us hang on to the hope, or, you know, it's just sort of baked into us that this is the reality that we're living in. But, you know, once you acknowledge the technology and the way that it would be implemented if it were, you know, if it happens or has happened already, I mean, it just seems really unlikely that any one reality, including this one, is the true reality.
And of course, there's a couple of arguments against it, which are, you know, in one of them, at least one of them are in the simulation argument. and this is, you summed this up very nicely in Thomas World. Almost all civilizations at our level of development become extinct before becoming technologically mature. In other words, to the point where they are a super civilization, right, so to speak, that can create these types of simulations, you know, far better than we can do right now. To the point that the players, or whatever you want to call them, the characters in the simulation are self-aware.
Right.
So, you know, one argument against it basically is saying we're never going to reach that point. Humanity's going to destroy itself.
Yeah, we're going to blow ourselves up first before we get there. And that's, you know, that's certainly possible. At the same time, it seems like some civilization out there somewhere is going to manage not to blow themselves up before they reach that point. So I agree with that. Likelihood is pretty high, but, you know, hopefully that's not the case.
Well, given that theory, it just takes one, right?
Right.
just one's got to make it.
And then all of this is kind of like Fermi's paradox. It's very you know, you can play with the likelihoods depending on the numbers, but we don't have enough information yet to know for sure.
Right.
So, you know, and the other argument I can think of against it, and I'm not, I don't know the answer, none of us know the answer, is that no matter how advanced a civilization is, it's impossible to create self-aware simulated characters. In other words, they're no matter how sophisticated the game or the simulation is, they're always going to be NPCs, non-player combatants. They're just robots, you know, and maybe they can pass a Turing test or come close to it, but, you know, that's about it. I don't know that I buy into that, but what are your thoughts on that?
I don't think it's impossible. It obviously is going to take a lot of effort and a lot more research to get to that point because, you know, computers that work in a binary world are operating completely differently than the human brain, which every neuron has hundreds of thousands of connections and all those neurons being interconnected. I mean, it creates internal computation method that is not anything close to what we're doing with our current computers, at least. But given enough time, I think that we, in my opinion, would get there. But it's a more difficult problem to solve than probably it seems on the outset, because just having enough computational power is not necessarily going to lend itself to sentience. But it just seems like as far as we've come, I mean, I'm kind of on the Kurzweil sense in that, you know, that everything is accelerating from a technology standpoint, and that we're moving exponentially toward, you know, the maximum amount of computation and
singularity. Ray Kurzweil is the guy, and he writes some amazing stuff on that front. Have you read Ray Kurzweil, Richard?
Oh, yes. I've read at least three of his books.
Yeah. He's fascinating stuff.
Yeah, and he's very optimistic. I tend to fall into line with him, but I think he's maybe a little more optimistic, or the timelines he proposes might be a little aggressive, but
right
on the right path.
And there's an emotional reason for that, because he's older than we are and he wants it to happen fast.
That's exactly right. He wants to live forever. He's convinced. Just around the corner.
Yeah. Well, you know, I would like for that to be the case, but I'm kind of, maybe I'm more realistic when I think about these things. I definitely think it's possible and more than possible, but I am not quite sure on the, it's snowballing quite as quickly as Kurzweil would want.
Well, he's the equivalent of the believers who are waiting for the second coming of Christ. Any second.
Right.
Definitely right. The next 20 years.
Charlie Strauss calls this the rapture of the nerds.
Right, yeah.
You know, but at the same time, you've got Carl Sagan and his demon-haunted world, and that's sort of more the less optimistic side of things, and that, you know, eventually our own demons and our lack of intellectual curiosity is going to consume the culture, which it sure seems that way lately.
You know, I was just saying to my wife, and I've said this more than once to a lot of people, that, not that you should, but if you only picked one nonfiction book to read in your life, it should be, in my opinion, Carl Sagan's The Demon Haunted World.
I would agree.
I mean,
I wish it was taught as a textbook. That's how much I appreciate it.
The baloney detection
chapter
alone is just, it's...
What's the title, Mike? Which Sagan book? The Demon
Haunted World.
Yeah, The Demon Haunted World by Carl Sagan.
Yeah.
It was like, I made a list of like, what were the 10 most influential books I ever read, and that was one of them.
Yeah.
Well, you mean give someone the tools to be curious about the world and find ways to make them things that you believe in pass the sniff test or the baloney detection. Just giving those tools to someone is so, you know, valuable. And it, you know, it doesn't seem like it's as common as you think it would be. But that's why I really appreciate Carl Sagan and everything he did for science and the world in general.
Yeah, we are definitely on the same wavelength with this. It's amazing that you brought the book up, because I said that to Danielle as well the other day, and she's a high school English teacher. I said, books like this are what should be taught in public schools, because it's a book that teaches you how to think.
Right.
And Carl Sagan was the type of guy who had this perfect balance between this wonderful imagination and this wonderful curiosity about the world and this wonderful optimism, but at the same time knew that the more you want to believe something, the more evidence you have to have for it. The extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Yeah.
Can I just share my favorite story Please. About Carl Sagan?
Absolutely.
He got called by a not well-known, not highly regarded, just a visiting astronomy student who wanted to be shown around Cornell. And I believe he drove his own personal car to the bus station, picked him up, took him to a few seminars, gave him a tour, chatted with him. It was Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I just think that's amazing. You know, that was Carl Sagan passing on the torch, you know?
He was an amazing guy.
Yeah, and you know, obviously he's known primarily for his nonfiction work, but I read Contact, his novel, back when I was, I think, in high school or college, and of course then the film came out right about the time that he passed away, and I think his entire worldview can be distilled into that film, and the way, you know, the battle between the sciences and between the religious, you know, side of philosophy and you know, the way that, you know, in the end of that story, even though a lot of people made fun of the end when she goes and meets her dad on the beach, essentially, but it's that emotional side of things that, you know, I guess these advanced, you know, civilization or whatever brought her dad to be the representative for them and the face of them to be able to have a conversation with them. But he had that sense of wonder and that sense of magic. I mean, it doesn't have to be a supernatural thing for it to have take that form. And then when she's sitting in front of the congressional committee afterward, and they're asking her if they are going to have to take her word, take everything on faith, that she really had this experience. I mean, it really turns his argument on its side and admits that we have to have faith, maybe not, you know, religious faith, but some type of faith in the world at large. And just, I think it was just really encapsulates everything that Carl Sagan thought and meant.
I'd agree. It's a really wonderful movie, and everything about it is wonderful. Not just, you know, the music, you know, it fits the movie to a T. I mean, it's a really great movie.
Yeah, I mean, the opening sequence. I mean, I've sat my daughter down, who's almost 8 years old, and had her watch the opening sequence just to give her an idea and a better visual understanding of the structure of the universe, because I can talk to her all day long about how large it is. And, you know, I've showed her the Hubble Deep Field image, and, you know, at that age, that's not quite catching on yet. She's not grasping that. But to see it visually and to see the camera pan back from the Earth and through all those, you know, various celestial events, whatever, is, she was pretty intrigued by that. And we're going to be watching that again and again as she gets older.
Every time I watch that and I see that opening sequence and that pan away from the Earth till it shows to a great extent, you know, just how small the Earth and our solar system and even our galaxy is in relation to the entire universe. I wonder how can, I don't pick on any one religion, but how can any religion think that there's a creator, a God creator of all of this, but yet he's got his focus on this one little tiny planet? You know, it just doesn't make sense.
A percentage of the one planet. Just
Yes, good point.
You guys in the right are good. Okay, the guys in the left.
Yeah, not very good.
The goats and the sheep.
Right.
So, yeah, speaking of religion, did Philip K. Dick turn you into a heathen then? Is that what happened?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
One of those.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, it just, again, thinking more about, my exposure to Gnosticism was a lot less until I started reading Philip K. Dick and understanding it better. I mean, I knew generally what the term meant, but once I read more of his work and then I did my own research into Gnosticism, it just, to me, stepping away from any of the, you know, the romantic nature of spirituality, but just the core idea of, you know, maybe the world has a creator, but the creator is flawed, and that's what allows earthquake, you know, in a very simple, in simple terms, having earthquakes and other terrible things that happen can occur because we're not talking about a loving, all-powerful God, but a God of some limited means. That just really made a lot of sense to me. I mean, I'm still by no means a spiritual or religious person, but if, again, I put it in terms of this alternate or simulated reality sense, I can easily see us being characters in some larger game.
Yeah. If God is all-powerful, he cannot be all-good and so forth.
Right.
You know, for those who are not familiar with Gnosticism, can you go over that a bit?
Yeah, I probably can't do it much justice. I haven't read on it very much in a while, but to me, just the idea of the world being created by a flawed creator. I mean, there's a whole aspect of it, you know, the history of Gnosticism and the Gnostic Gospels and kind of the breakaway from the Christian church at some point in the past that I could not possibly be accurate to try and represent that. But I know that there was a whole belief system around it. But to the extent of being able to go into detail about that, I wouldn't be able to do it justice.
No, but that's the meat of it, though. The idea that if there is a creator, he's flawed. You know.
Yeah.
And basically, well, screw up.
I think anyone who wants to retain some measure of spirituality in the face of the world and the way it seems when you look at all of the tragedies that occur. It seems like that's the way you would go, because at least then you can make sense of, you know, the world and how it doesn't always seem to fit the idea of an all-powerful, all-loving God, which, you know, as you pointed out, doesn't really hold water in the first place. It just doesn't have very much traction, in as far as I understand, in our culture.
Well, you know, who knows why that is, other than someone who's imperfect, you know, they don't see him as worthy of worship.
Right.
Yes. So
they want to believe in something greater than themselves. And a flawed creator sounds like you or me. I mean, it's not something supreme so much as it is just an accident, maybe.
Yeah. So relatively speaking, then, it may be a little bit like me. I didn't discover Lovecraft until I was in my early 20s, and I'm 45. So right. it sounds like you, and I read Philip K. Dick as a kid, and it's been so long, and as I told you yesterday, your books have inspired me to go reread some Philip K. Dick novels. But how many of his books have you read so far, and do you have some favorites? And talk about Philip K. Dick a little bit.
I like Valis. I like... I'm drawing a blank here.
No, it's fine. I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
Oh, no.
He's got a lot of work out there.
Yeah, Ubik is probably my favorite. It's the one I feel like is written, I wouldn't say mainstream, but it appealed to me somehow more than the others. I have actually not read the book that was turned into Blade Runner, and again, I'm drawing a blank on the name of that.
New Androids Dream of Electric Sheep.
Right, right. But, you know, and then his film that was turned into Total Recall, or the film Total Recall, that's probably my first exposure to Philip K. Dick that I was aware of.
Minority Report's another one of his movies.
And then he wrote a novel that, again, I'll have to go and brush up on my Philip K. Dick titles after this, but that essentially was turned into a novel that wasn't credited to him, which was The Truman Show. And it's the novel that he wrote about the guy that's able to help with, like, the United States or two countries are having some nuclear war, and this protagonist is able to predict where the next strike is going to happen based on some things that I've forgotten. But essentially, they create an alternate world, and everybody knows that he's in a fake world except him. So everyone that he knows is in on it. And that idea was, I hate to say ripped off, but turned into The Truman Show, which is essentially that story. And so The Truman Show is another one of these stories that are very similar to this that I really enjoy.
Yeah, you know, I really like a book, and it's making me think when I get my highlighter out. So when I was reading Thomas World, finishing it up yesterday, I highlighted a few passages. One of them is, people say they want to know the truth, but really they don't.
Right.
You know, and you were just talking about just now with the Truman Show ripoff or whatever you want to call it, where everybody's in on the joke or the whatever instead of this one, except for this one guy.
Right.
Mike, I just watched the movie The Big Short.
Yeah.
And about halfway through, they show this quote that was overheard in a bar in Manhattan where stockbrokers hang out. It's just like, truth is like poetry, and everyone fucking hates poetry.
That's essentially the same idea, right?
Yeah,
pretty much.
Well, I mean, whether you're a religious person or you're an atheist, it's just you seem like you want to know the truth, and you seem like you're on a discovery for that. But then when you find it out, it's not what you expect, and you know, then you really wish you didn't know.
Not what you expect, maybe not what you wanted, you know?
Right.
Here's another passage I highlighted, and I really liked this. Doesn't really even have much to do with what we're talking about at this moment. I'll get back to that, but I just want to let you know how much I liked this line. And this is from Thomas World, where before I had imagined life as a sequence of hurdles to be cleared, with Gloria, I realized it could be a long, satisfying journey whose destination was unimportant. I love that line, and I think that that's one of the keys to happiness. You know, not to derail the topic too badly, but it really is, you know.
Yeah,
a lot of people aren't happy until they, you know, I got this, now I got to go after this, and so forth. Sorry, what were you going to say?
Well, thank you for saying that. And I think it's something that I was learning during the writing of the novel. And I mean, if you want to take it, you know, he's talking about Gloria and he's talking about, you know, falling in love essentially. And from my own experience, when I was single, I felt like there was some achievement to reach, you know, that I was always looking for something and I wasn't sure how I was going to get there. But when I got there, I would know and then I would have achieved it. It was also similar to, you know, publishing my first novel. Like I thought, you know, the process to get to becoming a published author is fraught with hurdles, right? You know, it's a very difficult process if you're going down the path of looking for a traditional publisher. So when I finally achieved that goal, when I sold the novel and I saw it published, I was like, hooray, I made it, you know? And then I didn't realize there was this whole other realm beyond that of the books actually selling and,
right.
To generate interest in them. And, you know, that is one aspect of what he's saying. And then the other aspect of is, you know, I wasn't married at the time that I wrote that. And now I am. And now that I'm in a very happy relationship, you know, you can see that that achievement wasn't really the goal. It was more, I mean, yes, it is a goal, I guess. But then once you're there, it's the, what you experience going forward and finding basically a new reality. And that's another type of reality, right? Is I'm not trying to find someone anymore. Now I have found that person, and exploring the world in that way is very fulfilling. And you know, that line can be taken multiple ways.
Yeah. Well, I really liked it.
Thank you.
I won't bore everybody with reading multiple quotes from the book, but I'll just read one more.
For me, if you want, I'm fine.
Most writers I do this to are, yeah. There's so much of Philip K. Dick in the book Thomas World. You talk about what he called 2374 a lot. And right. I remembered this from, I had not thought about it in a long time, but from reading a book of essays of his called The Shifting Realities of Philip K. Dick, which anybody interested in this theme, I highly recommend that. But 2-3, I'm just going to read this now. 2-3-74, February 3rd, 1974, the day Philip K. Dick went crazy, or perhaps the day he learned the real truth. Is there a difference?
Right.
You know, and I remember from that book, Philip K. Dick talking about, I'm going to paraphrase this really badly, but, you know, how do you know that people in insane asylums aren't seeing what they say they're seeing, or seeing an alternate reality, or, you know, how do you know they're crazy? Maybe they're just different. Maybe they are crazy. But how do you really know? And if you learn the truth about the universe, would you really have learned the truth, or would you have just gone nuts?
Yeah, I mean, maybe the thing that you finally saw was what, when you finally saw the truth, is what turned you mad, right? I mean, that's a common theme. And
in Lovecraft, absolutely.
Our insane asylums are, that's not the proper term, but our mental hospitals are maybe populated with people who have seen reality. I mean, there's no way to really know. And that's, I think that's the most fascinating thing about exploring this topic at all, is just the nature of reality being, you know, particular to the person consuming it. I read an article recently, I wish I had the title in front of me, about the way that the perception of reality and the way that we're essentially creating reality in our own minds because we're not seeing the world as it actually is, which is photons bouncing all around us that are reflecting into our eyes that help us see, or the sound waves. I mean, you're creating a film inside your own mind, and every single person on the earth is consuming reality in their own personal way. Right. And I read in that article about how that we've evolved to perceive the world the way that we do, but that's not how it looks at all. And it's, when you get down to the very quantum physics level of understanding reality, it's hard to, you know, understand. It's hard to visualize because we've evolved to see the world more in Newtonian terms, where it's things are easily visible and make sense to us. And when you think about it in quantum physics something not being really there until it's measured or observed, logical sense to us, because we are not evolved to perceive the world in that way.
Right. I don't want to talk too much about Thomas World because I don't want to give out any spoilers here. But another aspect to all of this nature of reality stuff is solipsism. And, you know, we haven't even touched on that yet. You know, if you're living in an alternate world, if you're living in a simulation, are all the other characters, all the other players, are they really self-aware? Are you the only one?
Right.
There's no way to know that.
So. My whole issue with this is, if I was creating my own reality, I'm doing a shitty job of it.
Well, yeah, you know, like you wrote yesterday to me on Facebook, I have an easy chair and yours is difficult, so.
Well, and one of the jokes in Thomas World, and I don't want to be too graphic here, but I just...
That's fine, my audience is used to it. Kelly Young's usually on the show.
Well, you know, I just, you know, made the assumption that if you were Thomas, and if Thomas, in fact, has created his own alternate reality, wouldn't he make that reality a more pleasurable one, or one that is more positive for him? So one of the early jokes in the book is when Thomas goes to the bathroom, stands at the urinal, opens his pants, and what he sees is not what he expects, because the dimensions have changed. They're somewhat larger than they previously were. You know, and so that's a really early hint into what the story is really about, because if he were behind the creation of his own world, what's he going to do? He's going to make himself better. He's going to make things about himself better. And so that may be giving away a little bit too much, but it was funny to me, and I hope other readers, you know, picked up on that joke.
Well, you know, I don't think you're giving too much away, because if you pick up the book and, you know, on Amazon or in a bookstore and you read the synopsis, it hints at some things. The third paragraph here on the back of the book, what if you were Thomas? Where would you go? What would you do? What if you realized every person in your life had been scripted to be there? And what if the person watching all this time was you?
Right.
So,
and that makes it pretty obvious where the story is going, but what the ultimate answer is, I guess, is what the journey of consuming the book, reading the book is.
Right. So what about other, have you read a lot of other books, for example, other than, you know, Philip K. Dick, or what, just for fun, what books or what movies even would you like to recommend? Let's talk about that for a little bit. I mean, everyone's obvious first choice in all this is, you know, they shout out The Matrix, and they're not wrong, but, you know, for example, I was more impressed with The 13th Floor. I don't know if you've seen that one.
That was going to be the first one I was going to mention because, yeah, that influenced Thomas World heavily because, you know, the scene in that novel, in that film, where he drives outside of town and what he sees there just had a huge impact on me in the sense that if you were going to, at least with the technology that as we understand it today, if you were going to fashion some simulated reality, what would be the purpose of simulating everything? You would just simulate the important parts and conserve CPU cycles for that and not simulating things everywhere. I mean, when I was younger and I hadn't traveled as much, I used to have the idea of, well, if I fly to Phoenix, say, or Los Angeles, is it really going to be there? You know, just because the only way I've ever understood it to exist is either seeing it in films or on television or reading about it. How can I know for sure that it's there or not? And The 13th Floor, they address that question by not painting the reality that was unimportant to the simulation.
Right. Yeah, I love that movie. You ever read any Daniel Pinkwater as a kid?
I haven't, no.
He's a real, he's an NPR commentator, but he wrote children's books, and they're really funny books. And one of them, adults talk to a kid about the city, Los Angeles, and I don't know where they live, somewhere in the middle of the country, I think. And he's telling him, no, there is no such city as Los Angeles. And like, no, I know there is because I've read about it. I've seen it in movies and everything. He's like, no, that's all fabrication. I can assure you there is no such city as LA.
Some would argue that it's not very real, right?
That's true. That's an excellent example of a city that isn't real, actually. So what about some other movies?
Dark City comes to mind.
Yeah, man.
What was it called? Source Code?
Source Code.
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal, yeah.
He basically is in a he's caught up in a program. It's been some years since I saw it. I remember enjoying the movie, but what he is experiencing as reality is not reality at all.
Right.
Yeah, I've seen that, and I forget exactly what the storyline is. He keeps going back in trying to correct something.
Yeah, stop the bomb from going off.
Right, that's right, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was some kind of time loop, wasn't it? It's been a couple of years since I've seen it, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was that Matt Damon movie that I think was actually based on a Philip K. Dick story where where reality was fabrication and the men in the black hats were chasing him and the girl throughout the...
Oh, yes.
I think that was actually based on a Philip K. Dick story.
I don't think reality was a fabrication in that one, though, was it?
I think it was. Or they were fabricating it as they were going, because he would...
They were manipulating it, I think. But correct me if I'm wrong, it's been like 5 years since I've seen that one.
I can't remember what it's even called. I have to look it up really quick.
Adjustment Bureau, yeah.
Adjustment Bureau, yes.
That's very Philip K. Dick-esque, just in the sense of the man in the black hats. I mean, that was a recurring motif in his stories. I borrowed that, actually, for Thomas World as well. So Existenz is another one that's Jude Law is the star of that one. And it's very directly simulation-oriented. But then other stories like Shutter Island is a Dennis Lehane novel that was turned into a film. And in that one, even though the reality is essentially going on in the guy's mind, it's plays with the nature of what is real. I'm trying to think what else. Dark City, you mentioned. I just rewatched that recently, and that's pretty good. It plays its hand fairly early, but is the same type of story.
Yeah. Inception was a recent one.
Yeah. You know, Inception is a film that I really expected to enjoy, and it's extremely well made. I had a little bit of issue with the implementation of that because of the very strict rules around how much time was elapsing and the the factor of time in each level of reality that got deeper and deeper. I think it was like a factor of 10 or something as far as, and it felt a little too organized compared to what it would really be like in a human brain. But you know,
dreams are not like that.
I just don't think it's quite that organized, unless it was an alternate reality, you know, something that was constructed in a computer. But still, it brought that idea to a large audience. I mean, it was a fun movie to watch.
And I won't say what it is, but I really, for those who haven't seen it, but I really liked the ending.
Yes.
Philip, you had a question about Boys of Summer, I think.
Well, I wanted to ask about Boys of Summer because I really, really enjoyed it. And I already ordered Thomas World and I look forward to reading it. And without giving anything away on Boys of Summer, I guess one of the things that I thought about a lot after I finished the book and I kind of went back and I was tinkering with it in my head, trying to reason through your reasoning. So now I have the opportunity to ask, so I'm going to ask, the tornado, the catalyst for this sort of, awakening of, you know, of
reaching for spoiler free words.
I'm trying. Right. Exactly. And then of course there was the really, really fascinating, world, the coma, right?
Like, right.
And it's driving, and I'll have to ask you when we're not live, but I really want to know about that. But what I can ask you live that is interesting to the readers or listeners was the tornado, the chaos of the tornado being the catalyst that that expanded the characters' consciousness of the world, the world around them. Was it the mutual tragedy of it, or was it the energy of it, or like could it have been just as easily been a train wreck? Is, I guess, if that makes sense.
You know, the obvious way that it affected, the tornado affected the boys in the book is the fact that Todd was, you know, critically injured and was in a coma and saw the things that he saw or believed that he saw while he was asleep. But when you go back and look at very small details about the opening tornado sequence, you can see that almost every one of the characters in that sequence, once you've read the entire book, you know that they've been touched in some way by this, what's going on beyond the obvious plot points of the book. Right. So it was really, in my mind, I guess, the energy surrounding it, both the meteorological energy, but also the emotional energy of the people who were affected by it. So I think in a large tragedy like that, you know, it takes a toll on the psyche of a community. And Wichita Falls is a place where my parents, they grew up not in the city, but in a very nearby area. And I lived there for a time. And you could really sense the effect that something like that had on the community. And it almost, you know, I wouldn't call it a psychic energy necessarily, but, you know, some kind of communal experience that is part of what I guess I was touching on with that. And there's obviously other elements later, Survivor's Guild and things like that. But from a supernatural or a high concept point of view, really it would be the energy of that, of the storm is what kind of was the catalyst to start all this.
Excellent. That's what I thought.
You know, Philip, I'm really glad you brought up the Boys of Summer again, because first of all, for anyone listening, I really think you ought to read this. I don't say that lightly. When Second Life was, you know, all the rage, I don't know, half a dozen, maybe 10 years ago, 10 years ago probably is more accurate. I remember the first time I played it or immersed myself in it, I guess is a better way to put it since it's not really a game. And I was in there for like 3 or 4 hours. And when I stopped the program and started walking around my house again, everything felt weird. You know, it just, I had this weird reality bleeding into each other type feeling that I don't think I can adequately describe. And I bring that up because the only other time I've had that feeling is when I finished The Boys of Summer.
Yeah.
You know, so it's, I wanted to tell you that. And the other thing I wanted to tell you about The Boys of Summer is that when it really grabbed me was, you know, after I made the decision to read it, I should say, when I hit page 9 and it's talking about 10-year-old David Clark and, you know, the tornado's coming, he's down by the river in the woods, I believe. And he, in the text, you can start to see where, you know, somebody or something says, I can see you.
Right.
He ran as hard as he could. You know, branches were falling everywhere, you know, talking about the hurricane and so forth. He ran as hard as he could. He ran for his life. And now he thought he could hear footsteps following his own as if somebody, as if someone were behind him. And then he hears a mysterious song. You know, right. It's, you know, it very much broke the fourth wall. And it was the only other time I've gotten that feeling that I got the first time I played Second Life. It's a very effective novel.
Yeah. Thank you for saying that. It's, you know, I lucked out in the sense of the lyrics of that song, because that's a line from the Don Henley song, that is heavily involved in the novel. But obviously I chose it for that specific reason, because David can already sense on page 9, as you point out, that it appears that he's being watched, but by whom and from where? And obviously going into that would give away too much about the book, but toward the very end, when his reality is foretold or foreshadowed at the time of the tornado then, and then at the very end of the novel, the end of the of David's part of the story, and essentially those two realities are kind of layered upon each other, and I think he realizes then what he noticed. And there's also a point basically in the middle of the book where David is having trouble sleeping. He has insomnia, and he has this feeling that his life is being consumed by someone else's entertainment. And that's another point where the fourth wall is broken, where he wonders if someone happens right at that very minute to be reading about him in a novel. And of course, you are the reader of that at that point. And, you know, I like that kind of thing where, again, it pulls the reader into the story itself, and you become a bit player in the story rather than just a passive consumer of it.
And if I remember right, correct me if I'm wrong, but he yells out in his mind, you know, I'm not just a character, I exist, you know, yeah. I think and I feel, or words to that effect, you know?
Yeah, because...
Sorry?
It was a chilling moment when I read it, I remember.
Yeah.
Very vividly.
Well, because at that point, you would be possibly having some compassion for him, not only as the character in the story and what he's going through at that point, but also compassion for him only being a character in the story that you're reading. And so, to me at least, it makes it feel a little bit, again, I keep saying it, like you're more involved in it, but that you're really perceiving David in two separate ways. One, as what's actually happening in the story, and then two, the fact that that is his limited reality. That you are essentially consuming as entertainment.
So, you know, just for fun, as far as other books or movies, I'd like to throw a few others out there, and you guys please feel free to do so as well. Vanilla Sky is one that I enjoyed.
Yes.
We already mentioned The Truman Show. I'm going down a couple of internet lists here, because I know if I don't, I'm gonna forget to mention some. Yeah, Philip, go ahead.
I have a question, I apologize for barging in on the movie, but I want to sneak it in, and that is, if we could talk one more moment about the realities, the alternate realities, because one thing I wanted to ask earlier when you guys were talking about the computer simulation aspects of it. So there's also the scientific aspects of the multiverse and dark matter and blah, blah, blah. So what I'm curious about, and maybe this is a question, I guess I'm asking Richard, but is, you know, what is the greater belief? What is easier to believe? Is it easier to believe that there are alternate, you know, universes, you know, in infinity based on the science of it? Or is it easier to believe that it's a it's a computer simulation and there's a fault, you know, defaulted God in charge, you know, or is it potato?
Or a third question, is there a difference, really?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was saying. Is it super salad, you know? But that's one thing that, because I've always studied the more scientific side of it, and I haven't really gotten too much into the techno-science of it, that Rory Kurzweil is as close as I've gotten. But, you know, I'm more of Jeff Green than Rory Kurzweil. But anyway, so I was wondering if you had an input on that, Richard, if it was something that you'd thought about, or if you are more geared toward one or the other in regard to what you'd like to utilize for some of your fiction.
Well, when you're looking at the multiverse side of things, or in reality splitting every time a decision is made and a new world is created at that point, I mean, Blake Crouch obviously recently has explored that area in Dark Matter.
Yeah.
Which is fascinating that he created a novel around an idea that is difficult to understand, I think, for a layperson. But for me, the simulated side of things is a little bit more interesting to me, because maybe there's a way for us to touch that. I mean, obviously, on the 13th floor, for instance, one of the characters makes his way up the chain out of a simulation that's in the simulation to one level higher, and then finally to the level that they believe actually is the real reality. And if you're talking about a mini worlds or a quantum side of that, and those realities seem less likely to influence us, or us have a less easy time to interact with those things.
Yeah.
I like that idea, and I'm interested in it. But from a fictional standpoint, obviously Blake Crouch went down that path very successfully. But I, at least to that point, hadn't seen a way to create fiction around that.
You mentioned, I have never seen, I'm probably going to get killed for saying this, I've never seen the movie Westworld. And so you mentioned it in Thomas World. I can't remember. I think it's at the end, not in the novel itself.
Right.
I need to watch it, but I have a question. There's a new Westworld show on HBO, isn't there, guys? And is it the same type of thing? Because it sounds like a very interesting concept.
I haven't seen the show. I know that the original concept was, it was about a bunch of robots that come to life and you know, it's more of a Jurassic Park kind of thing. But I think
decide, screw you, we're not going to do your...
I think the show, the new show is a little more... I haven't seen it, but I think it's a little more philosophical.
I got to see it then.
Well, I've seen the first episode. It is far more technically proficient than the original Westworld film was. But that was another influencer on me, at least, because even though we're talking about androids, you know, instead of simulated reality, we're still dealing with the idea of these beings who may or may not be self-aware, and this reality that they're in, and what can they do with that, you know? And in Thomas World, toward the end, there is a scene where Thomas meets up with a character who is actually a violinist that is in a band called Godspeed You Black Emperor, who was influential for me in the writing of the book because of the, you know, the music and listening to music and being, you know, changing your mental state as you're writing. And so she's a real violinist that's referring to another band called Valley of the Giants that wrote an entire concept album based on watching the film Westworld. So like the layers of reality there are just so stacked upon each other that I was just trying to revisit it in my mind and was having a little bit of trouble, you know, bringing it back. So it's, I love again, that interconnectedness of media and, you know, books and films and the way that they influence the artists that create them.
So you've seen the first episode of the new Westworld. Does it stay along these lines? Since I'm interested in these themes, should I watch it, or is it deviate from?
For sure. Yeah.
For sure.
The original film Westworld, I think, you know, it touches on what we're discussing, but it's a little more mechanical. I think it's more, the original Westworld makes me think of the film The Terminator, because there's a man in black who is basically an unstoppable robot that's just chasing people around toward the end. Not to give too much away. The Westworld of HBO, as I think someone mentioned, is a lot more philosophical. more thoughtful, getting a little bit deeper. Obviously, when you're talking about a television series, I mean, they may have who knows how many episodes to explore the different themes there, but already the performance is there, and some of the conversations that the creator has had and some of the other technical people that are involved in the maintenance of the androids and the androids themselves, one of whom during the first episode becomes essentially self-aware, or at least aware enough to start asking questions about his reality, I would highly recommend it.
The original Westworld is more a theme of being in a role-playing game, which you know is fake, and then it becomes deadly.
Right.
Sort of like on Star Trek The Next Generation when you're in the holograph room and the safe go off.
I think there was a Fantasy Island episode that was similar. A book I was going to mention, by the way, Mike, is Prey by Michael Crichton.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Where the microbots gain.
Well, Michael Crichton wrote the original Westworld film as well. So.
Oh, did he? I didn't even know that.
He wrote and I think directed it also. So it's
really,
yeah.
So I'd like to recommend a book, and everybody listening to this, please buy Richard's books and read them first. But after you do that, Dan Simmons, he of the Terror fame and other books, great writer, has written a book recently in the last year or year and a half. It came out called The Fifth Heart. And I'll read a little bit of the synopsis, and you'll see why this kind of pertains to this conversation. It's the protagonist is Henry James, the writer, in 1893. And Sherlock Holmes is a character in the book as well. Holmes is currently on his great hiatus, his three-year absence after Reichenbach falls, during which time the people of London believed him to be deceased. Holmes has faked his own death because through his powers, the great detective has come to the conclusion that he is a fictional character. This leads to serious complications for James, for if his esteemed fellow investigator is merely a work of fiction, what does that make him? So, you know, here you have a guy who is extremely smart, a detective, Sherlock Holmes, you know, and through deductive reasoning comes to the conclusion that I'm not real. You know, so it's a very interesting book.
Yeah.
So, and there's I won't even say that. I would say read it. I don't want to spoil anything.
You know, another one that influenced me was Stranger than Fiction, and that's where Will Ferrell also realizes that he's a fictional character, and then goes and tries to meet the author of the works that he's in because she's trying to kill him off, essentially, and you know he doesn't want that for obvious reasons. So, you know, that one is kind of a melancholy story, and it's got a lot of humor involved in it, but touches on similar themes. And then, of course, Donnie Darko.
Oh, I love Donnie Darko. Yeah, is strange. I have not seen Stranger Than Fiction. I'm not a big Will Ferrell fan. Is it worth watching then? Or
I would say so. I mean, it's less about Will Ferrell doing his thing than about what we're talking about here and him trying to address that. It's a love story also, but it's I really enjoy it.
Yeah, he plays it pretty straight. I think you'd like it, Mike.
Okay. Well, you know, I'll wrap this up, but I do want to say something that I've had a lot of the same thoughts you've had, Richard, and I'm sure all of us have had to some degree or another. When I was 23, very long time ago, I was a pizza delivery guy in Des Moines, Iowa, where I'm from. And one night, I'm supposed to close, which means you work till midnight or one, you know, real late. So one night, a friend that I've not seen in, I don't know, years, walks through the door and he goes, basically asks me, you know, says hi and all that, how you been doing and everything, and asks me if I want to go bowling. This is all true story. And I've been bowling twice in my life, maybe before then. So I'm like, okay, well, that sounds fun, but, you know, I got to stay late and close, so I don't think I can go. So a friend that I was working with said, no, you go, I'll stand clothes for you. So we went bowling. So it was this midnight rock and bowl thing. And we were at the very end of the room, the big, it was like, oh God, must be 30 lanes. You know, it was a huge bowling alley. And, I'm bowling for a while and this girl comes up to me and asks me if I'm old enough to be drinking that beer, because I look pretty young. And a year and a half later, we got married. And we're still married. We just celebrated our 20th wedding anniversary.
Wow, congratulations.
Well, thanks. And I'm very much in love with her. I've got a beautiful son because of all this. And I've got her and I've got this beautiful 14-year-old boy, all because, number one, I was working at that pizza place on that night. My friend walked through the door that I hadn't seen in years and asked me if I wanted to go bowling. If my friend that I worked with had said he wouldn't close for me, I would have said, oh, okay, and not thought a thing about it and said, okay, I'm sorry, Derek, I can't go. So that's the third thing that happened. And then we could have been in the same, you know, the fact that she was there that night too, and then we could have been in the same bowling alley. It was huge. And never seen each other, but she was in the next lane. You know, it's all these improbable things that stack up for me to have met my wife. You know, maybe it's all coincidence, or maybe somebody's playing the game in my favor in that regard. I don't know.
Right. Well, the alternate theory would be that you would have met her regardless. It just wouldn't have been that.
Yes. True. That's what she says. Yes, there we would have found each other. So, you know, it's when you think about how easily it could not have happened, you know, and other things. I'm sure we all have stories like this, you know.
So yeah, I mean, the decision tree that was involved there and all the different branches that emerged from each decision or occurrence that happened is part of what makes life interesting and unpredictable. You know, I'm a very deterministic kind of guy in the sense that I feel like even though we appear to have free will, that the universe was created with the Big Bang and every particle interaction that was ever going to happen was already known if you had a computer large enough to compute that. So in that sense, right, that was already preordained to happen. But living in the real world, even if that's true, it doesn't feel like it's true, right? It feels like we're out there making decisions and things are happening either by random or by some causal event. So if determinism is the real way of things, at least we have the good fortune of it not feeling that way.
Yeah. And I try not to, I've thought about that a lot too. And I actually try not to, because I don't want to think about the possibility that I don't have free will, but yet there's a strong argument to be made that I don't, that we don't.
Well, know? there's a line at the end of The Boys of Summer, where, Thomas, the kid, turns to David because David says something to the effect of free will, or I want to do this of my own free will. And Thomas turns to him and says, free will, I like your sense of humor.
That's right.
And again, I mean, that's just touches on the underlying nature of what the story is about.
Well, the guy who came in late here is Pete Rolick. He's a fellow Nightshade Books author, by the way. So, Pete. Hi, Pete. Richard Cox.
Nice to meet you, Richard.
Pete Rolick. Pete Rolick evidently thinks having dinner with his family is more important or something. I don't know.
I'm not even supposed to be here.
So, anyway, Richard, I really appreciate you coming on the show. I've really been looking forward to talking with you, and I really enjoy your books, and I'm going to get the other two as well.
Well, thank you so much for having me and for buying the books and being interested enough in them to talk to me about it. It's been a really enjoyable experience.
So again, The Boys of Summer is your latest book by Richard Cox. Let me put Philip on the screen again. And
I'm your Vanna White.
That's right. And I'll be Vanna White for Thomas World. Here it is. I believe all your books are available on Kindle as well for those who got to run out and read them right now if they have a Kindle.
Yeah.
And the other two books are Rift and The God Particle. Am I remembering that correctly?
That's correct.
Okay. Would you recommend people start with The Voice of the Summer and work their way back? What do you, or does it matter?
Doesn't every writer think his last book is the best one? So, I mean, yeah.
It probably helps your career the most. If they want to see more books by Richard Cox, buy The Boys of Summer first and then go from there.
I like The Boys of Summer the most. I guess if you wanted to try to consume them in the progression of them, I mean, obviously, Rift and The God Particle kind of stand alone, although both of those books are tied together very slightly by a character that happens to appear in both of them. And then Thomas is obviously the main character in Thomas World, and he has a pretty significant part in The Boys of Summer in a very different reality. And then he's one of the main characters of my next book, which I'm
on. A version of him, Philip, you might say. Yeah.
Oh, man, I really got to read it.
Yeah.
No way to sell books, right? Keep touching them, bringing them together like that.
So there's a new book coming out? New book's coming soon? Is that what you said?
Good question.
I've finished and in the middle of a rewrite for a novel called House of the Rising Sun. In that book, a supernova appears in the sky and also generates an electromagnetic pulse that wipes out technology as we know it. So Thomas, in that novel, is a screenwriter who is now semi-famous because of the success of Thomas World, a screenplay that he wrote that was made into a movie that had a lot of success. So he's in the process of, he's written a follow-up screenplay called The Pulse, which is about an electromagnetic pulse from a solar flare that wipes out the technology on Earth. So in the middle of this, or at the beginning of this novel that he's in, the reality that he thinks he constructed as a screenplay actually comes true. And so he's faced with trying to understand how he wrote Thomas World, which became a film, and now he's written this new screenplay, which is in effect happening to him in his real life, and what that means for him. So that's the new one.
When will that be out?
I don't know yet. I mean, when I'm done with it, obviously I'll go through the process, the publication process. So it's probably a minimum of a year and a half away.
And is it a rule now? Song titles have to be the title of the book.
That's a happy coincidence, I would say.
Well, I truly have enjoyed the Boys of Summer and Thomas World, and I'm going to pick up the other two. And I encourage everybody to, you know, start with the Boys of Summer and go from there. So thanks for being here, Richard. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you very much.
So obviously, all you have to do is close your browser, and I'll kick you out of here. So
all right. Take
Enjoy
care.
The rest of your night.
Thanks, Richard.
Thanks.
Nice to meet you guys. Bye-bye.
Nice to meet you. Hey, Pete.
Hey, Mike. How you doing?
You're alive.
I am alive and kicking and, you know, frustrated and mad. And
How is the Florida hurricane?
Yeah. You know, pretty much destroyed everything I could possibly do that was fun this weekend.
Huh. Pete is here and we were talking Nightshade books.
Oh,
Matrix.
I don't even own a copy.
It's got a great cover. It's got this little, they make it look like an old 1950s paperback.
We worked hard on that. I even went for we did 30 or 40 different little cover taglines, trying to get as sensual and provocative as we could without crossing the line. But we ended up with that one. He could only love a dead woman.
I love that. Every time I post that, Lovecraft eZine, I get comments like, great cover. You know?
It is. It's a beautiful cover. And, you know, I was going to do this whole big book release party this weekend. And
well, obviously, God hates you.
God hates me.
Yeah, we were just talking about that.
That God hated me?
No, about, you know, there's a God of this reality, you know, if this is a simulated reality.
Yeah, and I wanted to mention, you know, you published my story called, God, it just went out of my head, about Pandora Peasley and the collapsing multiverses.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the idea that... at some point, the timelines don't become aren't stable anymore, and universes that are only slightly different start collapsing into each other. Because nobody really cares. And they can't tell the difference.
Depressing.
It's called A Sense of Time.
Is this your story you're trying to remember the name of?
I'm sorry.
It ties.
I know it.
Consider his age.
Yeah. It ties into our discussion of alternate realities.
Yeah.
Mike, you should read Dark Matter. Talked about it a few times, but it really.
Is that Blake Crouch?
Yeah, it's the new Blake Crouch, and it really gets into the primary focus is that reality splits every time a decision is made, and you create another universe every time you make a decision, and sort of what happens if you have access to those universes. I mean, it reads like a YA book, so it'll take you about an hour and a half to get through it, but it's an interesting concept.
I will definitely pick it up. I will say I don't buy that concept at all as far as – because what happens if an ant decides to go left instead of right? Is there another – why is it just humans?
It's infinite. You know what I mean? I don't know. That's what they say. They say it's infinite.
That's the basis behind the story, A Sense of Time, in that at some point, whatever decision you've made, even if it was conscious – at some point in the state of the universe, if that's the only difference between two separate universes, and everybody who observed that difference is long dead, the energy difference between those two universes should be negligible.
Right.
And they should collapse back into each other.
Right. That's a good point.
If an ant making a left or a right is enough to create a universe, everyone who watched that ant make that left and a right dying could be enough to collapse those universes back together.
I've never thought about it that way.
And this might explain a lot. Different memories and so forth and so on. But yeah, read the story again, Mike.
Okay.
It's in one of your issues. It's kind of fun.
And read Dark Matter, Philip, you're telling me.
Yeah, check it out. It's interesting. Okay.
There's a couple other things we could talk about, but we're going to try and experiment here. I don't know if it'll work. If it doesn't work, I will bleep it out of the podcast version so you don't have to put up with it. But Kelly Young, our reporter on the scene of I have a price. We'll get into that in a second. Reporter on the scene, Kelly Young at the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival. Couldn't get him in Google Hangout on his phone. Probably because of picnic issue. So I'm going to see if... Can you guys hear this ringing?
Yeah.
All right. See if we can get him on the phone.
Hi, Mike.
Yeah, Mr. Trump? Wrong. Is this Kelly Young?
You called me on accident.
Is this Mike live? Can you guys hear him?
He does sort of sound like Donald Trump.
Is everybody hearing me?
They say you do. Yeah, they can hear you. You can't hear. I don't know if you can't hear them, but.
No, I can't hear them at all.
No, but they say you sound like Donald Trump. So.
A little bit. I have a tremendous voice, just like Donald Trump.
Unbelievable. A lot of people have said it's unbelievable. So give us a report on the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival then.
Well, the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival is fantastic, as it always is. Despite what you may have heard, the panels have been wonderful. The films have been really, really spectacular this year. It's a 24-hour party like it always is. Been up till 3 every morning, and at my advanced age.
Oh, I know.
A bit too much. We got a really, really great response to our film, The Package, and I've had people coming up to me all weekend telling me that was their favorite film, so...
Unbelievable. Really nice. You should tweet about that and end with an unbelievable response.
And a tremendous response.
Tremendous.
Really great.
And those other films, sad, sad. All right, thus ends my political commentary.
I've got a little bit of a scoop for you here. I saw Mike Griffin talking to S.G. Joshi, if that means anything to anybody.
Joshi. The name rings a vague bell, yes.
Interesting.
So he went over there to shake his hand, and then at the last second, he pulled his hand back and stroked it to his hair instead, and then just walked by.
Griffin did?
No.
Oh, Joshi did?
I'm joking. They did speak to each other about the video and all that. So,
oh, I was hoping it was true. That would have been a scoop.
Video at 7.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you guys have spoken at all about the review, but everybody who's listening, I'm sure, knows all about it.
We have not. The guest, Richard Cox, just left, and so I said, what's the most important thing we could do now is get Kelly Young on the phone. So that's what we're doing.
Oh, good man. Good man. So that was a bit of news, and I've been able to sit down and talk with a couple of people for a fair amount of time. People like Ross Lockhart and Wendy Wagner and Anya Martin, people I never get to see. So it's been a really tremendous show for us.
Tremendous. Can we get back to Griffin for a second? Did they hug or just shake hands?
I don't know if they actually shook hands. They spoke to each other, though.
Okay, and there was no fisticuffs or anything, so that's good.
Well, not as of yet. There's still one more night to get through, so...
You have a video app on your phone, right?
Right. I'm not sure that I can actually videotape it while I'm kicking a person when they're on the ground, though, so we'll find out.
Good point. All right, so what other reports do you have for us from the film festival?
Like I said, the panels have been great. It is a packed show this year. The sales for us, especially Issue 20, have been phenomenal. And it sure looks like everybody is having a really, really great time.
Yeah, looks like it from my vantage point on Facebook. So
everybody wants to touch my jacket.
Pete says he hates you, by the way.
By the way, Pete, I just spoke with Derek Koch, who was very disappointed that you weren't here because he was off to do his panel without you.
Wait, say that again?
You spoke with who? Who's disappointed, Kelly?
Derek Koch.
Derek Koch?
Oh, okay, yeah, well.
Does the Monster Kid Radio podcast?
Oh, he says, he knows who, yeah. He can hear you, but you can't hear him. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's really about it. You know, we're staying at the famous Banfield Motel.
The murder. That's the murder hotel. Yeah. Any news to report there?
And Andrew Migliore has shown us around town to various little hidden distilleries, things like that. I don't know if any of you guys know this, but I like to drink whiskey on rare occasions. So that has been a high point for me.
Yeah. Are you drunk right now? As we are speaking?
Really, the question should be, are you sober right now?
All right, anything else? Lots of copies of Strange Eons sold, and there were some other books there too, I heard.
Yeah, and everybody says hi to Mike Davis and wishes he was here. This is the last night of the festival, award ceremony later. And then everybody begins drinking once more for the last time.
All right. Well, thanks for the live on the ground report.
Absolutely. I hope everybody is having a fantastic weekend and a great podcast.
Yep. And we'll see you next week, buddy.
All right, man.
Talk to you soon. Bye.
Bye.
Son of a bitch.
So, Mike, this is, this is completely unconnected, but the only thing I want to say right now is as God is my witness, I thought turkeys could fly.
What? What are you talking about?
Something about the way you interacted with Kelly, it reminds me of this old episode of WKRP in Cincinnati where they're giving turkeys away for Thanksgiving, and they're dropping them out of the helicopter.
Well,
oh, yeah, that's been reporting.
I haven't thought of that as a prize.
Yeah.
We could. No, I blame the fact that we had to do it this way. You know, I could take full responsibility for it, but the truth is it's all Kelly's fault. I mean, we did a video test earlier and, you know, couldn't make it work. So I blame him.
All right.
So now we tried to do a Google Hangout with his iPad and then with his phone, but just didn't work out.
He didn't bring his laptop with him?
Well, the problem was it would have worked on his iPhone, I'm sure, but the internet connection there where he was really, really spotty.
Yeah, it's all the weed in the air.
Yeah. Well, I've been there, and it can be spotty in some places. So anyway, we got anything else to talk about?
First review the Reanimatrix are in, and it's, you know, 9 out of 10 positive.
Oh, that's good.
I'm only one-third through it, so when I'm finished, I'll write a review.
I appreciate that. One person says I don't have a very high opinion of women, but...
Oops.
You don't?
It's a hot topic.
I'm just mad at you because you ruined one of my favorite musicals.
Dirty Dancing?
No, I was saying MAME.
Oh, MAME. Yes. See, but now it makes sense, doesn't it?
I'm not sure. I have to rewatch the film.
Yeah, so in case you don't know, characters from MAME, Dirty Dancing, and a whole slew of other shows and things that I love.
And it's sometimes difficult to track. MAME you'll catch very easily if you're familiar with it, but Dirty Dancing was a little tricky to catch.
Yep.
Use the full name of a character.
Right. The funny thing is that when I wrote that chapter, which is set in the Catskills, I was going to write... It was actually going to be about sort of a prelude to The Lurking Fear and talk about the people that worked in the camps to build the reservoir that is in the Catskills. And I almost was halfway through that when I got an advanced copy of The Fisherman by John Langan. And a good deal of that book is set amongst the camps of the people that were building the reservoir. So immediately had to shift gears and talk about, you know, something completely different that was set in the Catskills.
Go ahead, Rick, I'm sorry.
You also mentioned somebody called Old Man Zump as a Catskill legend.
Yes.
What was that from?
Actually, Old Man Zump is a reference to Lee Clark Zump.
Okay, that's what I immediately thought of.
Yeah. Sure, why not? All right, so Mike, you had a question?
Yes, why don't you like women?
Why don't I like women? I don't know. I love women, and women love me.
Well, I knew that. Why did you get accused of...
Obviously. Some reviewer said that, you know, when once I switched gears from Robert to Megan, she didn't enjoy the book as much, and I must not have a high opinion of women.
Can I make a comment about that without becoming a sacrificial lamb? And I've noticed this because, as you guys know, I'm fairly new to the genre writing field, and I've only been out and about for about a year now, and I have some new stuff coming out. But it's interesting. I don't know how else to say it. It's interesting how sensitive and PC the horror world seems to be. More so, I think, than even mainstream fiction or literary. I don't know. Maybe that's just social media bombardment, or maybe it's Donald Trump backlash. But I got a little bit of it with Alter, just a smidge.
Go on.
And it shocked me because, in other words, you like, you know, it's art, right? It's creativity. Right. It's almost, it's making me a little bit nervous. And that we're almost getting to a point where even in your fiction or even in your creative, I mean, Eminem is a great example, probably the far extreme, but where you're judged as you would be as a person. And it makes me nervous a little bit. It makes me nervous as a writer. I have to think about it a lot when I'm writing. Is this going to offend somebody or is this going to offend somebody? And then I think, damn it, man, I'm writing like horror books. Like this should be open game. But I don't know if you guys, what your thoughts on that are, if it's worse than it used to be or not worse. Again, I'm scared just to say worse. Like I'm
no, gonna, I want you, you to, know? No, look, if we're going to get different. Crucified for calmly discussing and asking questions, then I'm fine with being crucified. Because if we can't discuss things in a calm, rational manner, if we're not even allowed to discuss it, then where, you know, all hope is lost. Where are we? So no, I do want to know what you think. Has it gotten worse?
Well,
I don't know. I can tell you that I a lot of time feel like I'm damned if I do and damned if I don't. So,
right. What?
Well, I'm in this weird position of I'm getting conflicting messages.
Okay.
The message I got for a long time was there are no women in your books. There are no minorities in your books. There's no LGBT in your books. Okay, great. And not me, but that's the what I heard in the world. And then I hear, well, you're straight and cis, so you can't write LGBT characters. And you're male, so you can't write women. And you're Anglo, so you can't write African-American or Hispanic. And I'm like, wait a minute. Which direction do you want? Who is right here? And the answer is that nobody and everybody. And there's a really – it's – you. If you are going to complain about an author only, and we've heard it, only writing about white men, then you can't attack them for writing when they write about black women or Asians or this or LGBTs. You can't have it both ways. And I'm not sure how we resolve that issue.
Yeah, I've felt those conflicting messages as well.
And I don't know that I have it.
Yeah.
Feel free to crucify me over being confused over the messages that I'm getting from critics. Because I'm not sure how to handle it.
I heard on a podcast about 6 months ago, a weird fiction community podcast, that, quote, you should not write what you know. You should write what you don't know. In other words, you should write, if I'm a white male, I should write a black female or a Native American and so forth. And then lately the message has been, don't do it. Or maybe to be more precise, what I'm hearing is if you do it, you better damn what it exactly right. At this point, I have to tell you, I would be afraid to write not other characters, but protagonists that weren't white males.
Yeah. Well,
there's a lot of conflicting messages out there.
It's the characters, but it's also what the characters say, how the characters act. That's what kind of drives me crazy. It's like, just like, you know, like I wrote a book, my early novel, The Egotist, which was about a guy who was a very egotistical person. It's a character study, and he's a horrible guy. And a lot of people who read it go like, is this you? Or why do you think this? Or how could you ever think that about women?
It's
like, right. It's like, that's not, no, you don't understand. I'm creating a character to show that these, and you know, the reality is these people exist, and I'm writing about people that do exist. And, you know, and things happen. Like one thing I had to say about Alter a lot in defense of Alter when it comes up is, look, bad things happen to good people. And bad things happen to kids, and kids think some messed up stuff, and parents think some messed up stuff. And I could sit here and ignore it, or I could go write Driving Miss Daisy or Bridget Over Madison County or whatever. Like I could go write that gentle literary fiction, but I'm trying to write stuff that has an impact. I'm trying to write stuff that it gives you an emotional response, that creates some discussion, that creates a little bit of remembrance in your mind that dents your brain a little bit. And it's concerning to me because that is sort of why I like to write, why I love writing. And lately I've been a little nervous because it seems like there's a lot more, and maybe it's the vocal minority, but it seems like there's a lot more kickback when you don't do things a certain way, or when you, it's okay to have somebody lop off 20 heads as a, you know, in a serial killer, you know, rage, but make sure your female strong, your characters are strong enough, yeah, or don't talk a certain way, or don't get treated. So it's just an interesting thing, and it's something, my initial response is to ignore it, as Stephen King, I'm sure, has in his books ignored a lot of the PC culture. But I'm also just seeing it seems like more and more, at least in the horror world, like it's an issue, like it's a hot topic. And
yeah,
I do think you have to be respectful of, I think it should go without saying, they have to be respectful of, you know, genders that are not your own, races that are not your own, cultures that are not your own. At the same time, I think there's a lot of righteous indignation out there, and that the truth, I've said this before, is usually in the middle. It's not one extreme or the other. And I don't know, maybe part of the answer is to write what you feel the need to write and ignore the critics. That's usually what I do. And I think possibly is it, I'd like to propose that maybe they're taking all of this a little bit too seriously. You know, both sides. None of us, look, I hate to say it, none of us are curing cancer, man.
No, well, I was reading a Facebook thread earlier, and it was about poor Dan Simmons, right? Dan Simmons is getting barbecued on Facebook, which is another topic. Yeah, which we won't discuss. It's a political topic, which is fine. Like, I don't have a dog in that fight. But
sure.
But then people are getting into talk now. But then it kind of became a thing where, like, now we're going to talk about Dan's books, and what, and you know, Dan's, you know, in this book this was really misogynistic, and in this book, and I was like, good Lord, what? Now we're not even talking about the topic. Now we're talking about fictional characters, and then it starts. Then another guy gets on, and he starts talking about, well, I just read a Hell House, and that was the most sexist thing I've ever read, Richard Matheson's Hell House, and I'm like, dude, like, I don't know, like, where does it stop? Like, why don't we? You know, you're talking about one of the all-time classics in the horror genre, and to classify it, it's not a book about men and women and feelings. It's a book about a haunted house. And again, I'm not defending one or the other. I just feel like literature should be literature, and fiction should be fiction, and reality should be reality. I wish there wasn't so much crossover sometimes with people's feelings.
Yeah, Matthew gave me an example of a, I asked him to send this back to me, because I think that a lot of people that take this really, really seriously, Matt had to go earlier, a lot of perspective, there are far more horrible things going on. This is from Matt. I saw a young woman in her late 30s, early 40s, who had anal canal cancer. Typically, this can be cured, but often patients get severe burns, you can imagine where, during treatment, that make daily toileting and hygiene a torment. Chronic effects of treatment, sterility, menopause treatment, surely. He goes on and names, this is just one of his patients, named all these horrible, horrible things, mm-hmm. And then he gets on Facebook and says, see someone worried about, you shouldn't buy used books because that's horrible, you know, or right. This character in a book was sexist, you know. Have you never been through anything or seen anyone go through anything horrible in your life that you think all this stuff is horrible?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm making my point adequately. I know that people who have been through a lot don't take this stuff very seriously, and people who have not been through much take it very seriously.
Well, and not only that, but I think that also there's a sort of desire to see the world as a perfect world, and the desire for, among some people, to have that perfect world portrayed in literature that way, and it should not be portrayed in any other way. And this is why you end up with people trying to ban Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn, because of racist language and racist situations. Never mind that that's one of the whole points of the book.
Right.
Similar with To Kill a Mockingbird. You know, the point of the books is to highlight this particular way of thinking and events.
Right.
And bring them to the forefront and let people talk about it and perhaps do something about it or recognize it. To try and whitewash the world. Oh God, that's, you know, and that itself is a.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think maybe it boils down to, no, some people are not going to like you no matter what you do, either through jealousy or they just don't like your face or whatever. Right. And whatever you do, you're not going to make some people happy. You could be a superhero running around flying, saving people, and somebody would be pissed off that you didn't get to them on time, even though you're doing, you know, it doesn't matter what you do. People are going to, some people right. are going to hate you and some people are going to love you. Right. So, you know, maybe the answer
haters
is.
Haters going to hate.
Haters going to hate. But at the same time, that's not an excuse. Be as kind as you can in the real world, as respectful as you can, you know, try to be a good person. And, but reality is reality and literature is literature.
Yeah, it's very odd to me that, you know, some of the people who I've read over the years who have written some of the most horrible books I've ever read are some of the nicest and most caring people and do so much for others. It's just amazing.
Horrible in what sense?
Well, no, horrible books, you know.
Dark.
Horror books, not bad books.
No, oh, okay.
Yes.
It's surprising that these kind and gentle people have these right. fantasies of monsters ripping people's heads off, is basically.
Well, I'll name one named Graham Masterton.
Right.
You know, writes some pretty horrific fiction and has some pretty bad scenes.
I'm reading White Bones right now.
No, there you go.
It's one of the, it's in my pile. Yeah.
But,
it's pretty horrific, yeah.
He was one of the founders and editor for Scarecare, and he does charity work all over Europe, mostly in Poland. He's a nice guy. You wouldn't think that he would be that kind of writer.
Yeah, and you know, I look at guys like Philip. Take a look at Philip's Facebook feed sometime, and what you'll see is a whole bunch of promoting other people. You know what I mean? And a lot of it's, I see a lot of people who seem very eager to jump on the things that you mentioned, Philip, you know, alter, let's find something to wrong with it in that regard. They're not doing those things, mm-hmm. you know? So, anyway, I didn't know we were going to get on this topic, but I do think it's a really important one.
It's interesting. I mean, yeah, well, it's interesting to me. I think, you know, I just hope that there's a differentiation in people's minds. And I just hope that also, you know, the things that are important to discuss in a public forum are left to public forums and not something that carry over into art. I hope that there's, I think it's important for art to bring things to the forefront. I think it's great when the statement is made. I've made statements in my creative work. I also, but it's a messy subject because I would like to just make sure that the characters that people are created and the situations that are created are seen as fantasies and as things that are, you know, not put there to hurt, but put there to enrich and, you know, discussion and thought. And I think that's the important thing that people need to make sure they understand when they're reading, especially horror, which can get pretty messy.
Yeah, and also the fact that one of the reasons why I never, rarely, I can't remember the last time I did it, discuss things like this on social media, Facebook, or on the internet, basically at all, is because I can't seem to have a calm discussion. And the reason why I do discuss it and want us to discuss things like this here is that have a rational discussion without us screaming at each other. You know, and the one with the most righteous anger is the one who wins. You know, it shouldn't be that way. It should be, whether we agree or not, it should be a calm, rational discussion, and you don't see that very much.
No.
So, yeah, that's a good example. You mentioned Dan Simmons. Philip, I have not seen what you're talking about, but it sounds like a political argument and spilling over into, okay, yeah, let's crucify Dan Simmons.
It's exactly. It turned into a bit of a barbecue, and to the point where I swear to God, I was like, oh, Philip, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. But at one point, I was like, I got on there, and I was like, all I said was, hey, you know what? This sounds like it was a misunderstanding, and this is a really ugly, savage, personal attack that you guys are doing. I think everyone should just take a breath. And that was my whole thing, because I just felt bad. I just felt like, look, this guy's a grandfather. He's got kids and grandkids, and he's a person. And the attack was brutal. And it was all because he used irony in a sentence. He said he called men meek who supported or who got upset about Trump's comments. It was a political, and of course it became a feast because, and he was like, and his whole defense was, look, it was a joke. And it didn't matter. He was over. It was over.
Let's pretend for a second it wasn't, though. It's ad hominem. You know, debate the argument on its merits. I think political arguments are, you're never going to win one. You're only going to lose one. But if you did, or you debate anything else, you debate what you're debating. You don't say, by the way, screw you, which is basically what's happening.
Yeah. Then they drag poor Richard
Matheson.
You're
wrong because you're a bad person and your books suck. That's why you're wrong.
Yeah. And Hell House sucks too. You know what? You know what? As a matter of fact, screw horror.
Screw you. Screw Dan Simmons and screw Richard Matheson. You know, I win the argument.
It's a bad idea just to read any books whatsoever. You should just burn them all.
Yeah.
His newer stuff, maybe.
Yeah. Well, guys, thanks a lot. Really appreciate you coming on. And good to see you again, Philip.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. It's fun.
And Rick and Pete, thanks for being on. And let's see, who do we have next week? And we'll do prizes, podcast. Help if I actually had this stuff up. Next week we have nobody. So we're going to do a show, just one of our regular talking about whatever crap comes up shows. And then on the 23rd, we have Douglas Wynn talking about his new book. So, prizes if you want. What was Matt giving away, Philip? He was giving away
Larry Barron audiobooks and Cthulhu Fatang.
Cthulhu Fatang was a print copy of Cthulhu Fatang is what Matt's giving away. And thanks to Larry Barron, I'm giving away, or I should say Laird is giving away, four audiobook downloads of X's for Eyes. So we've got a total of five prizes. If you want one of them or more than one, send an email to Lovecraft eZine Prizes anytime now in the next week, next through next Sunday. Today is October the 9th, 2016. Lovecraft eZine Prizes at gmail.com and put the in the subject, put either X's for Eyes or Cthulhu Fatagan, and I'll randomly choose somebody a week from tomorrow and email you. So thanks a lot, and we will see you next week. Thanks, guys.